Hello. Greetings to the AIDA workshop in Lausanne. When Leopold Tarlitz asked me about 1 year from now whether I would like to speak here at this workshop, I said immediately yes, for two reasons. I like the atmosphere at EPFL, so it would have been great to spend a few days there. And at that time we were just starting a project where AIDA would be very useful. And it looked like a good idea to report after 1 year what were our experiences with AIDA from a user point of view. Unfortunately, many things can happen in 1 year. And the first thing that happened is that we are organizing a workshop ourselves on a different topic this week. And for many reasons, it had to be exactly this week. So no chance to be with you. And the other more serious thing that happened was due to delays in the AIDA development, we could not use AIDA for the project as we had it in mind. So I'm lost. I do not have anything to tell you today. I am not an experienced AIDA user as I would have liked to be. I don't want to spoil the program of this workshop, so I try to find something, an alternative that is nevertheless useful for you. So I will describe the project as we have carried it out without AIDA. And I will try to highlight at which places in the project it would have been so great to have a fully developed version of AIDA available. I hope that will demonstrate to you as interested AIDA users or potential AIDA users, and to illustrate to you at which places in a scientific project AIDA could be a helpful tool. And it is a helpful tool, believe me. So how do we do this practically, this talk? This video has been pre-recorded in the first place to be sure that you would not suffer from any network troubles, nothing worse than sitting in a conference, watching to a remote talk, and then halfway the talk, the internet disappears and, well, chaos in the program. So by pre-recording, we avoid that. But I will be listening with you to the same presentation. I will follow the online interactions that we will organize in the next half an hour. And by the end of the talk, I will join you over Skype or another video conferencing tool to discuss with you, to answer your questions. You have two ways to interact with me during this talk. So at any time in the next half an hour, you can go to this Google form. Either you scan the QR code or you go directly to this address and you can type your questions there. I will monitor that page during the talk and so I will prepare answers to your questions. And at a few places throughout the talk I will ask you a question and you can answer immediately via this address. Either you scan the QR code or you go to this address, visit this room, and you will see the questions appearing there. Maybe somebody can press the pause button of the video such that you have the time to go to these two addresses, to have these ready in your phone, and then we go on. My story starts way back in time, 1993, which was the year when I started my PhD. And at that time I was an experimental researcher. I was working in a lab with radioactive samples, perturbed angular correlation spectroscopy, measuring hyperfine interactions. And around that time the first publicly available DFT codes came on the market. With publicly available I mean DFT codes that were not restricted to be used within the theory group that was developing them, but that were aimed for a non-specialist audience. That was very useful for me at that time, so slowly I changed from being an experimental physicist to a computational physicist. And in order to assess the value of a tool as AIDA, it's useful to see how people interacted with DFT codes back then. So 1993, that means the time of old computers. What did my university had as a computer at that moment? Well, they were very advanced. They had a few modules of this, the IBM SP2, Scalable Power System. That's a machine that was one of the best high-performance computing systems of that era. And one of these modules had a performance of 1 gigaflops. I just tested 10 minutes ago, the laptop on which I'm recording this talk has 20 gigaflops. The biggest HPC system in the world in 1993 had a performance of 60 gigaflops. So this was a powerful system at that time, but by far not as good as the laptops all of you have in front of you. Imagine doing a DFT calculation on such devices. One calculation easily took several days. And with one calculation, I mean a static calculation for a unit cell with, say, 4 or 5 atoms. No geometry optimization, just solving the Kohn-Sham equations for one static cell. We didn't always use these HPC systems of the university. After a while, we found out it was way cheaper to buy common off-the-shelf desktops, put them in racks without a screen, and let all of these work together as a parallel computer. That was in the mid-90s a very popular way to do. I show you these pictures to illustrate how technically complicated a DFT calculation was. And even these user-friendly codes by today's standards were not at all that user-friendly. I had to invest one full year to be able to perform a calculation independently and be confident that I operated the code correctly. Summarized in one picture, one DFT calculation is a big machinery which you have to put to work. Things have changed very much since then. Our codes have become much more user-friendly. Our hardware has become much more performant. And you see that in the number of publications. Here you have many times seen graphs like this. The number of publications that mention density functional theory have exploded compared to 1993, which was here. Back then, it was perfectly possible to publish a paper, say in Physical Review B, where you report 1 or 2 or 3 DFT calculations. And the paper was entirely about that topic. Nowadays, that would be impossible. And why? Not because DFT is a worse method now, but because it has become so easy to do a DFT calculation. There is no creativity in this any longer. Sometimes I say everybody can do a DFT calculation nowadays, and something that everybody can do is not something a physics journal wants to publish about. Where is now the creativity? Not in being able to do one DFT calculation, but in combining many different DFT calculations and other quantum chemistry calculations and experimental input, and to combine all these pieces into some project that learns you something more about the physical question you ask. So it's not about one DFT calculation, it's about many. And with many can be thousands of DFT calculations. And that is where a tool as AIDA comes in. You know the ADES model. I'm sure the people at the workshop have told you about this in yesterday. And this automation aspect, the A from ADES, is a very important one. Nobody is able to perform 5,000 TFT calculations without making human mistakes. So if you want to go to that number of calculations, it's absolutely mandatory to have a workflow manager as AIDA. The scientific project about which I want to talk, and that illustrates these and several other advantages of a workflow manager, is about verification and validation of DFT codes. And I will treat these two topics separately. The first part will focus on verification. In another terminology, the precision of DFT codes. It's asking and answering the question, are we building the thing right? Are we producing, implementing a DFT code that performs the task it should perform, solving the Cohn-Sham equations in a numerically correct way? We have many DFT codes on the market, really many, and the question is, how do you examine whether they are all working correctly? If you think about it, how would you tackle that? Well, that's what I ask you. Go to that Socrative tool and answer the question in one sentence if you can. If you feel safe about the correctness of a DFT code, the numerical correctness of a DFT code, why do you feel safe? What are your arguments to trust that any DFT code you are using is solving the Cohn-Sham equations in a bug-free way? I'm curious, what are the arguments that are important for you? Please stop the video at this point, take 1 or 2 minutes to answer this question, and at the end of the talk I will show you what are the highlights of your answers. How do we examine whether all of these many DFT codes on the market are working correctly? That's a question that remembers me to my childhood. That was the time even before computers. And pocket calculators were then the devices that were, well, the thing where a technology-interested child would be playing with. That was the time when these machines were entering the households. And it fascinated me as a 10-year-old child whether that device would be always correct. Could I find an addition of two numbers, of which I could verify by pen and paper that it was a correct addition, then do this addition on the pocket calculator and spot that it would produce an incorrect result? Would it be possible to find such a counterexample? So I was trying many, many different additions with simple numbers, calculating on paper, doing on the pocket calculator, and the pocket calculator was always right. I was not able to find a mistake, so I had to conclude that device was working correctly. If you don't have the pen and paper solution, the best alternative would be to take two pocket calculators from two independent companies and give them both the same task, the same set of tasks, and always compare whether they perform every one of these tasks in the same way. As long as there is no difference, you can trust that they are working correctly. If there is a difference, then probably one of the two has a problem somewhere. That's the game we will be playing with DFT codes. We will take two different DFT codes, and many more of them, but always in pairs of two, give them the same tasks and compare the differences. What are the tasks we will give them? Well, we take a set of 71 elementary crystals. It means crystals with only that particular element. For iron, that will be the BCC iron crystal. For manganese, no, this is not manganese, magnesium. For magnesium, the HCP magnesium crystal. And always the ground state crystal structure, that is the ground state for that element. And we will do something, calculate with DFT something for these 71 elementary crystals. What will we calculate? We will calculate energies for 7 different volumes. We take a reference volume that by preliminary calculations is known to be close to the equilibrium volume of the DFT prediction. We take a reference volume and 6 other volumes that are in steps of 2% straddled around that reference volume. For these 7 volumes, we calculate with the DFT code the total energy and plot that on an energy versus volume graph. Then you fit an equation of state to it, and that's your piece of data with which you will continue to work. You do this task with 2 pocket calculators, 2 DFT codes. And so you have an energy versus volume curve for one of these crystals with code 1 and an energy versus volume curve with another crystal with code 2. You put them on top of each other and you calculate the area between both energy versus volume curves. If that area would be 0, it means the 2 energy versus volume curves are perfectly overlapping, are perfectly identical. If they are not identical, the area will be slightly different from 0. And that quantity, that area, we call delta. So if you hear about the Delta project, which is the name I will be using, that's the task of calculating such delta values for pairs of DFT codes for 71 elementary crystals. So a specific example, you take the FCC copper crystal, calculate energy versus volume with Wien2K, calculate energy versus volume with VASP, and the delta value for these 2 calculations turns out to be something like 0.78 millielectron volts per atom. We will see later that this is a small number, and that means in practice that these 2 codes are producing the same result. So you don't do that only for FCC copper, not only for this one here, but for all these 71 elements. You average over all cases, and the average difference, the average delta between Wien2K and VASP is 0.3 millielectron volt per atom. That captures in one number the overall difference between these 2 DFT codes. And as I said, this is a small number, so it means that these codes very well agree. In terms of AIDA, how would you define such a workflow? Because what I just described is an elementary workflow that has been used a lot in this Delta project. You take 3 different nodes. 1 data node that defines the crystal structure, say FCC copper, for a particular reference volume. And 2 dictionary nodes, 1 that serves as input and that tells I will be using the Wien2K code with a basis set of that size, with that many K points and so on, all the numbers you need to specify the Wien2K calculation. The structure is rescaled such that you have these 7 different volumes. You run 7 different calculations with them using these input settings. That gives you 7 different energies, and that results in, after a fit, that results in the equation of state parameters that are the output of this work chain. That's how you did it in how you would do it in AIDA. That's not how we did it. At that time, we did not have AIDA available yet. I saw on the program that this is exactly what you will be working on today. So we are here in the program, and the next hands-on session is writing your first workflow equations of state. So if you wonder what is the use of that, in this particular project, it would have been very useful. So this is the aspect of an environment with workflows and later on leading to data analysis on the produced results, which is something where AIDA would have been very useful for our projects. We did this manually for 40 different DFT methods or DFT codes. I make the distinction between DFT codes. Win2K and VASP are two different DFT codes. But within one DFT code, you could use different methods. For instance, different pseudopotential libraries. If you change the library, you change the performance of the DFT code. The results will not necessarily be exactly the same. So these are different methods. 40 of them we compared. And on this big graph, you see a pairwise comparison of 40 methods with 40 methods. You always see the delta value, this average delta value, average over 71 elements, for any possible pair of codes. This matrix is redundant. It's only the one of the triangles that has the unique information. And to have an easier reading, it's color-coded. So if things are green or yellowish, it means the delta value is small. The codes are producing the same results. If it's orange or red, then there are larger differences. That matrix was produced handmade. So every researcher contributing to this project had to provide a data file with delta values or equation of state parameters for their code. And somebody had to assemble all these numbers in a big spreadsheet and extract that matrix out of it. Having AIDA, where you could store all these different data in a more consistent way, and doing the analysis in an automated way, would have been very useful. It was not available, but nowadays one definitely would want to do it with such a tool. Also for the aspect of sharing, different codes use different units, electronvolts or Rydbergs or Hartrees, angströms or Bohrs, to have everything in a consistent way, to have correct translations between the codes without human mistakes. And also for that reason, AIDA would have been the ideal tool. Let me elaborate on a few interpretations of that matrix. I zoom in on the subset of all electron codes. So here you see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 all electron codes. And there is a pairwise comparison now between the all electron codes only. You see all the numbers here are below 1 millielectron volt per atom. That's a very small delta value. All electron codes really agree with each other. If you want to translate that in observable quantities, this would correspond to differences between two different codes of 0.01 angstrom in lattice parameters or 1 gigapascal in a bulk modulus. All scatter of that order of magnitude is normal. This is due to slight differences between the all-electron codes. If you go to pseudopotential codes, so these are a few examples of ultrasoft pseudopotentials, like the GBRV14 pseudopotential set within Quantum Espresso, compared to all these 7 all-electron codes. And you see that also here, the numbers are really small. So these ultra-soft pseudopotentials perform as good as all-electron codes. They produce the same results. They give you the same predictions. Unless you use quite old pseudopotential sets, like this Vanderbilt 2 pseudopotential set, gives you delta values that are much larger. Now again, a question to you. Would old DFT codes, the ones we were using in the 90s, be as good as the ones we are using right now? Why or why not? Take a minute to think about that question and answer in 1 or 2 sentences. Well, one way to examine how DFT codes changed, how the precision of DFT codes changed over the years, is to compare historical versions of codes. So here you see a table where we examined several historical versions compared to current all-electron codes. And you see that if you use VASP in 2007, with the pseudopotential library of 2007, then the average delta with all-electron codes is 2. That's not dramatic, but it's higher than we saw in the previous tables. That went down to 0.8 and 0.6 with more recent pseudopotential libraries. Similar story for CASTEP, where we could go back to 1998. A 6.5 delta at that time, now 20 years later it's down to 0.7. All of these results have been published in the paper which you see referenced here, and you see from the author list that we are not the only ones who worked on this. Of course not, we are not the experts in all of these DFT codes. Now, people that made these DFT calculations were expert users, or in many cases even developers, of the DFT code that was being tested. And we never all came together in one room. This is the biggest grouping we ever had, about 20 of us. There were in total 69 people working on this. So about 20 of us at the Psyche conference in San Sebastian in 2015. The results of this comparison, they are still being updated. So if people want to test new pseudopotential libraries or new codes, then they can still do that in a manual way, not yet automated with AIDA. And if they report it to us, we keep track of this on this website, which works, but is less ideal than it could have been. If all of this would have been done inside AIDA, then the data, the access to the data, would have been much easier than it is now on that website. But at least the data are there. That was work of a few years ago. I said when Leopold asked me about this workshop 1 year ago, we were about to start something new. And I want to describe now what the elaboration of the Delta project, the next step in the Delta project, is about. What I described so far was using this 71-element dataset. Now, you can criticize this set of crystals. Several arguments against it. The most obvious one, this dataset is perhaps too small. If you want to examine the performance of a DFT code, or even better, the performance of a pseudopotential library with only 71 elements, that's not good enough. You want to have more crystals where every element, every pseudopotential is tested in more structurally different environments and in more chemically different environments. That would be a real test of the pseudopotential. Does the pseudopotential behave in the correct way for all of these different structurally and chemically different environments? Also, 71 elements, that's not the entire periodic table. So if you want to test pseudopotential libraries, you better want to test the entire periodic table. So you want to have all elements covered. And if anyhow possible, we also want this test to be rather fast, ideally something that you can run overnight, because then you can also use it to test the correctness of a code. If you are in an ongoing development, by running the test every night, you can see whether no bugs have been introduced into the code. So what would be the tests, the new test set we have proposed for this? We calculate again an energy versus volume curve. Now for all elements, Z running from 1 to say 95. And first of all, for four different simple crystals. FCC, where every atom has 12 nearest neighbors, BCC with 8 nearest neighbors, simple cubic with 6 and diamond with 4. This tests structural diversity. And that's nothing exotic. People, code developers, pseudopotential developers have been using such tests, maybe in a somewhat less systematic way, for decades. The next one is chemical diversity. And that's a bit more elaborate. We propose 6 different binary oxides that are cubic, that have no internal degrees of freedom. So the volume is the only geometrical degree of freedom. And they are constructed in such a way that the oxidation state of the other element varies from +1 to +6. Several of these crystals will be totally nonsense in the sense that you will never find them in nature. There is no hydrogen O3 probably. But from a computational point of view, an all-electron calculation for such a crazy crystal should produce the same result as a pseudopotential calculation for that crazy crystal. And it's a strong test of the transferability of a pseudopotential that it would agree in all of these cases with the all-electron prediction. So imaginary crystals that are structurally diverse, imaginary crystals that are chemically diverse. Now let's complement that with a few handpicked crystals. The two previous sets were very systematic sets. Now we will take a non-systematic handpicked set of binary crystals, but now not binary oxides, generally binary crystals. Say 5 to 10 different binary crystals for every element, handpicked in such a way that we have a few insulators, a few conductors, and a few ionic compounds, a few covalent compounds, a few metallic compounds. So scanning chemical diversity also in that way. These three test sets together, they are certainly not too small. They cover all elements. In total, you have about 1200 crystals. And I would claim that this is a minimal set you need to really test the structural and chemical transferability of a pseudopotential library. As fast as you can. You scan them a maximum number of different environments without having hundreds of thousands of crystals to consider. How far are we in that respect? So the old test sets, and maybe this slide is a little bit outdated because things have progressed so far. And all test sets have been constructed and reference calculations with several VASP libraries have been performed, and for a few of them also Win2k calculations have been performed. And the idea is, once we have these reference data available, then it will be an easy game again for people using other pseudopotential libraries, using other codes, to run these 1200 crystals through their code and to compare it with the reference calculations and to have an overall delta out of that. The people who are involved in this are Kurt Lejagre from Ghent University, who has also been the driving force behind the original Delta project, Martin Carlsen, a postdoc who is working with us since 1 year, and who is working on these oxide, mainly on this oxide test set, and Thomas Roux from the Technical University of Vienna, who is working on the handpicked binary test set. Let me illustrate by one specific example the kind of data that would result from such a comparison. And I will look at a particular PAW library in the VASP code, the so-called GW-ready potentials. Now, for the original Delta test set, the one with the 71 elements, the element barium had a delta of 0.3 with respect to Win2k for this GW-ready potentials. If you run it through our new test set 1, the four different structurally different environments for VASP, for barium, then you find these low delta values. Everything okay. If you would look at the band structures with the two codes for BCC barium in this case, they are perfectly agreeing with each other. If you look at the oxides, then with barium oxide, no problem, it's a very small delta value. If you look at barium oxide 3, then there are differences. And don't look too much at the details. This slide is, well, a few weeks old, things have evolved, but the story is that we do observe with some libraries meaningful deviations from the all-electron calculations, and actually the GW-ready potentials in VASP turn out to be much better than their previous generation. You really need them in order to stay consistent with the all-electron codes. But that's a separate story that's still under development. And also here, the agreement in band structures is perfect, which itself, if I look at these pictures, I always find that amazing. These spaghetti pictures of a band structure that seems so random, but two computer codes developed totally independently from each other, if you ask them to calculate the same pictures, then they are in such big detail in agreement with each other. So that's more or less my story. Again, I apologize not to be an expert AIDA user, but I hope that I have shown you in which cases a tool as AIDA would be very meaningful today. And I'm pretty sure that with what you will learn at this workshop, you will be able to define workflows that would be able to tackle the task of that Delta project that I just described. Maybe I should add why in the last year we did not use AIDA, because that is something you would certainly ask me. The reason is that our reference calculations were going to be done with VASP, and the AIDA plugin that can interact with VASP was still under development. So Martin Carlsen, whom you just saw in the pictures, he has been working also on that VASP plugin for AIDA, And I don't know exactly what the current status is, but I hear that this plugin has progressed a lot in the past year. So this is the end of the video part of this presentation. I will now join you over a conference tool, and I will come to you with the answers you have given to the questions I asked you, and I will have a look at the questions you asked via the forum. And if there are any other questions, please put them in the forum right now. Or maybe if the audio connection is sufficiently good, you could even speak your questions directly.